So we're going to get started. I'm very excited to be moderating this panel. I'm Michael Barr from the University of Michigan. When I was first approached, Peter Zimroth first approached me about participating in this panel. I was very intimidated to serve as a moderator. If you look at your programs, you'll see I am the only moderator who is not a co-director of this center. And I am the only moderator who knows nothing at all about civil procedure. From both those perspectives, I was a little intimidated. I thought, well, maybe they're going to make me a co-director and make me take a class in civil procedure, and then I could share this. I should also say I really know almost nothing about smelly washer dryers or whatever that case was. I once tried, the closest I would come, I would say, is I tried once to fix a dryer. And it ended really badly. So I don't recommend any of you out here who are lawyers, which I think is probably most of you, I don't recommend lawyers try and fix dryers. So what am I doing here? I teach and write about financial regulation. And a lot of the activity we've been talking about that you think of as cool, neat examples of civil procedure, I think of as really interesting examples of whether financial regulation is working or not working. When I haven't been teaching at Michigan, I've spent two tours of duty in the U.S. Treasury Department. Most recently for President Obama in 2009 and 2010. And one of my jobs there was to develop the Credit Card Act of 2009, which substantially changed the rules in the credit card industry, and the Dodd-Frank Act, which substantially changed the rules in the rest of the financial industry. And one of the things we did in the Dodd-Frank Act was create a new Consumer Financial Protection Bureau that has not fully market-wide coverage in consumer products, but relatively broadly. And we gave, among other duties, the duty to the CFPB to study whether consumer mandatory pre-dispute arbitration clauses should be prohibited or conditioned in some way with respect to consumer financial products and services, which is a pretty broad area of concern. And we gave similar authority for studying investor products to the Securities and Exchange Commission. And in both cases, at the end of those studies, the relevant agencies have the authority, if they believe it is appropriate, to prohibit or condition mandatory pre-dispute arbitration clauses. The CFPB also has the authority and has already issued rules banning mandatory pre-dispute arbitration clauses in mortgage contracts. And as most of you know, there has long been a prohibition, although it has weakened in recent years, on the use of mandatory pre-dispute arbitration clauses in investment advisor contracts, because investment advisors are seen as having a fiduciary duty, which until quite recently people uniformly thought precluded that type of action. Whereas broker-dealers traditionally have offered and included mandatory pre-dispute arbitration clauses, and there is a vibrant arbitration industry in the securities sector. So we have these quite different, conflicting, alternative approaches to thinking about the use of arbitration clauses in the consumer finance and investor protection areas, and I think it is a very important and ripe subject for conversation and importantly for research. And I was thrilled to learn that that all of you were interested in this topic too, even though you thought it was about civil procedure. We have a terrific panel this afternoon to help us think through those issues. Each of them is likely to take a slightly different perspective. David Noll, who coincidentally is a Judge LaValle clerk, which is the other reason I thought I might have been invited to this panel, because Peter is a friend of the judges and Troy was a former clerk of the judges, so that's the other unifying theme here. And Mark has appeared before Judge LaValle. I'm not sure why Adam got invited. It was just a mistake, Adam, but you could make up for it by being just super excellent on this panel. David is going to talk to us about contract procedure as a way of enforcing public compliance. So there's a nice broad frame on the issue. David, for those of you who are judges in the audience, David thinks you all are secretly members of the national legislature, and he's going to explain why that's a good idea. Adam is going to also present a broad frame looking globally at the ways in which public and private enforcement have been converging, at least across the U.S. and Europe. And then Mark, I assume, is going to tell us why all this is nonsense and not the business of the courts. So without further ado.
Pleasure to be here, really excited to be invited here. Today, I'm going to talk to you about something a little different. I've been asked to talk about, or when I talked to Troy, he said, I want you to talk about, kind of the next steps. What beyond the class action, or what an alternative to the class action can kind of serve as our government-sponsored mechanism as providing a means for collective redress. And the claim I'm going to make today is there's a new trend, both in the U.S. and abroad. The U.S. is moving beyond just reliance on class action attorneys to provide collective redress, but increasingly, attorneys general, federal prosecutors, agencies are moving to compensate victims on a massive scale in a way that looks and resembles class actions. And as that's happening, whether it's through the Department of Justice or state's attorneys general settlements or the CFPB, so it's also occurring in Europe. In Brazil, in the UK, in Sweden, increasingly new powers are being vested in governmental authorities, not only to seek public kinds of concepts of deterrence, but compensation as well, mass compensation on a large basis. So the Competition and Markets Authority recently in Great Britain, the Danish Consumer Ombudsman, and the Australian Securities Investment Commission all have now expressed powers to seek mass compensation and provide the compensation to a large group of victims, while at the same time pursuing an enforcement action. And I'm going to posit that this trend poses a new challenge for judges. Maybe not in quite the same way across civil and common law jurisdictions, because judges have different functions and have different responsibilities across those jurisdictions. But to the extent that in many of these countries, judges are still tasked with reviewing the fairness of these large settlements, they may find themselves confronting some of the same types of difficult questions that we've confronted in class action law for years. Problems associated with how to coordinate cases across different jurisdictions, ensure people adequately participate. How do we overcome different conflicts of interest and distribute the funds fairly? And I'm going to suggest today that as government actors are increasingly seeking to compensate people for mass harm through public agencies along with class actions, It's gonna raise new questions about what we want and expect from our judges to do in determining who to defer to in setting the appropriate amount of compensation and awards. I'm gonna suggest that maybe there are some tools already happening on the ground here in the U.S. that are being pioneered by U.S. federal district court judges that might show one path forward. Ways in which courts are already beginning to kind of coordinate amongst each other when there are overlapping class actions and compensatory actions brought by agencies to coordinate, to ensure that people are adequately notified, to ensure that ultimately we don't risk over-deterrence and over-compensation in these types of action, in all these types of actions. But as I suggest this, that maybe we can rely on the U.S. model, I'm also going to kind of suggest that, well, maybe there are other models to look to, too. Now, in the existing literature, there's actually been a burgeoning literature since Jack Weinstein published a paper over 15 years ago that has been describing the ways in which increasingly criminal law and administrative law and class action law have begun to overlap, not only in the ways in which they try to accomplish the goals of deterrence, but also compensation. Increasingly, as agencies compensate large groups of people, as agencies seek restitution from some wrongdoers, they are increasingly distributing those funds to large groups of people in ways that look like class actions. And we're seeing the same thing by government prosecutors as well as other types of public actors. And this idea of convergence has been well explored in other types of complex litigation context. There's been a burgeoning literature about the rise of managerial judging. The ways in which our American judges are increasingly acting a little bit more like their European counterparts in the ways that they use magistrates, more inquisitorial methods, particularly when they handle mass and complex litigation. Many people have observed that when judges are handling mass litigation, they have, in some cases, taking on a more hands-on approach that we might not traditionally associate with the U.S. judicial system. Others have described the rise of formal aggregative systems and class actions abroad. Over 22 different countries now have adopted class action rules themselves abroad. And when you combine that with like the backlash against formal class actions here in the U.S., it looks like actually we're kind of converging on this model for how we generally handle mass claims. But there's yet another trend that I want to suggest is occurring that also I would call almost double convergence. It's the way in which both in the U.S. and abroad we're seeing public actors try to accomplish these similar goals of mass compensation. Although my PowerPoint's not working so well, but public actors, as I said before, they include agencies. So, and this is just my back of the envelope calculation, but when you put together restitutionary mass judgments kind of rendered and distributed to victims by the SEC, by the FTC, by the CFPB, in the OCC, it was over the past decade, it's been about $12 billion. The Department of Justice, in terms of its mass compensation through criminal restitution, it's been about 10. And these are just different examples of some of the target defendants in all these cases. And the National Mortgage Foreclosure Settlement, a big chunk of change, but almost over $30 billion associated with some of the different types of distributions associated with that settlement. But this slide kind of illustrates, just as all of these different countries have begun to adapt different types of aggregate ways to group together things, they've also given their government bodies new powers to also accomplish very similar goals, to go after wrongdoers, and then to, whether they're through collective redress orders or through becoming lead members of class actions themselves, offer compensation on the same kind of retail basis. And in the U.S., this trend, this move towards public compensation, can be identified and attributed to three things. One is an increasing movement within the U.S. system, especially in criminal law, driven by victim rights movements, to afford victims restitution for crimes and for other wrongdoings that occur when there's an administrative wrong. Also, the rise of corporate dispute resolution has changed the way corporate defendants have responded to those types of actions. And then finally, this new kind of model adopted by the DOJ to not only try to try cases and to settle, but to reform business practices through settlement has also created this opportunity to seek mass compensation at the same time. In Europe, we've seen a different kind of trend that's leading towards convergence. In Europe, they've recognized that there's a need to afford peace in some kinds of mass litigation cases. And so that's one reason why they've adopted some formal mechanisms for aggregation. But because they're so worried about recreating the monster that is our American-style litigation system, they've put public actors in charge of handling a lot of mass distributions at the same time that these class actions also kind of proceed. In some ways, you might say, well, that's totally unremarkable. Like, that's what we kind of expect of civil law jurisdictions around Europe, particularly jurisdictions that historically have relied on agencies rather than private parties, not only to enforce the law, but maybe to afford forms of compensation. Throughout Europe, they've long relied on piggyback actions, actions that follow up on criminal prosecutions to afford compensation to people. But what's notable about this trend is that, A, it's part of an express movement to approve collective redress. This is actually part of a movement where laws are being amended in part because there's a concern about the rise of a large group of cases and how they should be handled by judges. And the second is that, at least with respect to some of these jurisdictions, it's the court that's still overseeing the terms of these settlements that might involve many different players against the same defendant seeking overlapping potential awards and forms of restitution for those defendants. What I want to posit, and how much time do I have?
You have
seven and a half minutes. In the 7.5 minutes that I have left, what I want to do is suggest that some of the same types of problems that have historically been confronted, the same challenges of class action law, can also kind of appear in the context of public settlements. And I want to suggest at least, I'm going to give you some examples of some of the attempts to try to deal with coordination problems behind overlapping actions, the struggles that government actors face, just gathering enough information to provide adequate compensation, the distribution problems that they sometimes face, as well as arguably different conflicts of interest. And then at the end, to kind of at least raise the question about whether or not we can handle some of these problems through some judicial responses that have been advanced in the US. So some examples of coordination problems. After private attorneys commenced this lawsuit against UBS, they were just on the eve of settlement when they claimed that 19 states' attorneys general hijacked their settlement efforts. They set up a second rival fund to compensate people and municipal entities who were wronged by UBS's conduct. The plaintiff's attorneys were quoted at the time as saying, "This is what happens when you have two ways to kind of reach the same endpoint. The defendant has a choice of picking door number one or door number two." Scott Rothstein is popularly discussed in bankruptcy law circles because he was a Ponzi schemer who used to have lavish cars all parked in front of his home, and I think he had about 19 different cars. When it was ultimately revealed that his law firm was kind of a front for a Ponzi scheme, shortly after it was revealed that the scheme was taking place, there was an involuntary bankruptcy proceeding that was filed against him. But criminal prosecutors also brought a case against him, seized the awards, and began distributing those funds through a criminal restitution action before the involuntary bankruptcy proceeding can get off the ground. Even though that money arguably went to different groups of people under a different type of compensation scheme and might have undermined the priority scheme that we typically privilege in bankruptcy, there aren't really any formal rules for dealing with what happens when you have simultaneous bankruptcies and criminal restitution actions or criminal forfeiture actions that take place at the same time. Sometimes government agents struggle with gathering information. So another Ponzi schemer known as the Minnesota Madoff, Tom Peters, there was a large distribution plan that was proposed, but the judge ultimately received over 100 different objections claiming that they lacked adequate information. And the judge said that the entire government-proposed award was one that was replete with errors and incomplete information, revisions that sometimes dropped people's claims by hundreds of millions of dollars. The independent mortgage foreclosure review received a lot of attention after some GAO reports said that their attempts to spot check banks that were deciding how much to compensate individuals who might have been victims of robo-sign mortgages as well as other types of practices, they were criticized for not doing adequate checks on whether or not the awards that were being distributed through the independent region were truly independent or were truly correct. And finally, there have been problems associated with distribution and conflict. So the DOJ used to have this program called the Extraordinary Restitution Program. And a lot of the problems associated with this program were kind of like the problems and some of the issues that we raised with respect to Cypre. So there was a deferred prosecution agreement. Bristol Myers Squibb negotiated with now the sitting governor of New Jersey, but at the time, the federal prosecutor of New Jersey, and they agreed to fund an ethics chair at Seton Hall University, which was also the alma mater of the same prosecutor. And that raised concerns that this kind of this type of distribution, which kind of looks a little bit like Cypre because the money couldn't go directly to victims in that case, might raise certain types of questions about conflicts of interest as well as whether or not the money is sufficient. And so in 2008, the DOJ actually has barred this practice, and since that time, they usually will not allow terms that make the defendant pay funds to a charitable organization unless there's some exigent circumstances. last distributional type of conflict that sometimes can arise, and it's actually come up in the Madoff distribution. So after kind of the Herculean efforts of Irving Picard to distribute enormous amount of funds from to the Madoff victims, there's been a second fund that's been created through the criminal prosecutor and through criminal forfeiture. And Picard expressly said, look, I don't think I should be able to, I should handle this action. I think I'm too conflicted because there are different victims at stake. And it really has produced new conflicts because now Richard Breeden says that Picard's fund is not doing it right. That actually you should be coming to my fund. The problem with Picard's fund is he's distributing monies away from the true victims, the widows and orphans. It's better to go through the criminal justice system where we can adequately compensate those who are true victims. And what's really kind of going on here is we have a civil process that's meant to handle one group of victims and a criminal process is meant to handle a whole group of others. And no way in which to kind of rationalize what these funds are about and how they should be coordinated and how we should deal with those potential conflicts. 1 minute. Let me skip past this. The implications for this is that public actors are increasingly playing this important role, but they may experience some of the same types of problems that we just see in mass settlements all the time. This doesn't mean that it's wrong. I want to make sure that I make clear to any government attorneys in the room that I'm not critical of these efforts. I think that you should be lauded for these efforts. But I do think it means that as these efforts continue, we need to kind of give some thought to how we rationalize them, how we rationalize coordinating overlapping actions, obtaining information, and reviewing potential conflicts of interest. One way to move forward might be some of the experiments that federal judges have already begun to explore. Joint trials, so there's been a lot of cases where a judge like Judge Rakoff will sit in a joint trial with the bankruptcy judges to try to sort out all of these types of coordination problems up at the beginning. Coordinated notice between courts. Judge Marrero has suggested that maybe a judge overseeing a class action should be able to review the notice that's going out to people in a government distribution fund when it's pending against the same defendant. And judicial review. Maybe we need judges to review at least, not in a detailed way, the substance of the settlement, but at least to kind of serve as that fail-safe to ensure that the agencies, the government actors, when they are distributing funds, are doing so in a rational way. But that's not the only way forward. Certainly, coordination could take place through the executive branch as well. That's arguably already happening with the SEC. As well as there, you could just kind of say, maybe this all should happen privately, which is arguably what's happening in cases like GM. Maybe it's up to the defendant ultimately to be coordinating all these types of things and be seeking out information from private outreach groups. So the major questions that I think this poses is, is this truly a global trend? You know, and I think you can see there's a global trend in that government attorneys around the world are taking a bigger step in compensating large groups of people. But the second question is, like, will courts really adapt in a way that more aggressively manages what's kind of going on, or will they ultimately step back and, like I just did, ultimately allow other parties to kind of shape how those questions are answered? But the central question still remains, which is, like, what is the role of our public adjudicative system in providing a rational system of compensation in a world of overlapping regimes that compensate people sometimes for the very same wrong from the very same defendant? Thanks.
Thank you, Adam. That was terrific. I got a little worried when you stepped back there that if you fell, all the speakers in the room would sue NYU in a class action for the fear that your misstep, you know, would cause them the next time they got up there. That was supposed to be a joke. I think Adam's paper and presentation is terrific, and I think it helps us see the fluidity and the connections across the public and the private modes of adjudication, that a kind of narrow focus just on private adjudication, whether it's in the form of arbitration or class action or suit, might obscure, and we can begin to see those trade-offs in mode. And I also particularly liked Adam's use of the international evidence we have that shows there are lots of different ways of organizing society. Sometimes in the United States, we're a little stuck in the particular form we have here. And seeing that other countries have done this mix in different ways, I think, is really useful. I should also say, Adam didn't say, but I do think there's this other dynamic going on that's quite interesting. Adam was mostly focused on the ways the public sector reacts to this the executive branch reacts to this mix of modes, but also there is this judicial role that has been playing out quite differently in Europe in the last 5 or 6 years in a way that's new to civil law traditions, where you have judges, for example, in Austria, really inventing collective redress as a mode of dealing with relatively weak Austrian public enforcement of financial regulation. So there is an interplay that I think is really worth studying much more carefully, and I'm thankful to Adam for making us look at it. David.
Okay, so I think the question Adam is getting at, and that all of us are getting at on this panel, is if we're in a post-consumer class action world, then what? What are the alternatives? What are the institutions? What are the procedures that are available to serve sort of the same regulatory role that civil procedure folks are accustomed to seeing class actions performing? So Adam gave you one alternative. I call this the public alternative, which is that you have something that looks a heck of a lot like a traditional consumer class action, but instead of being conducted under Rule 23, it's being run by a public agency, which has power to collect restitution, make distributions, do all the things we do in a class action under whatever its organic statute is. I'm going to talk briefly about what I'll call the private alternative, and particularly the possibility that dispute resolution systems that are set up by contract, most prominently arbitration, can perform a role that's similar to what we've come to expect from the class action. Particularly in the Supreme Court cases in arbitration, we see the idea that privately designed ADR systems can provide compensation, deterrence, can serve a regulatory function that's similar to what public court class actions have done. There's not really a better advocate for this position than Andy Pincus. He has completely sold the justices on the idea that if parties are channeled to private one-on-one arbitration, the regulatory functions that we want the law to be performed are going to be performed just as well. And in doing so, we're going to dramatically lower the transaction costs that are associated with public court transactions, class actions. So the question that raises for policymakers is just what should we do with these systems? When we have a dispute that's governed by a contract that purports to direct the parties to a privately designed ADR system, what should the policy response be? And I think if we look at that question, that that provides a way of getting at the relationship between private ADR and class actions that we want to see in public courts. So let me start by talking a little bit about the promise and the perils of privately defined dispute resolution systems. For the promise, I'm going to go all the way back to a 1972 case that started us down this road. It's called the Bremen. There were two parties to an international maritime transaction. They were trying to tow an oil rig from off the coast of Louisiana to the Mediterranean, somewhere in Italy. You can see there's a huge need to coordinate the activities of different jurisdictions, to coordinate different dispute resolution systems. We're going to be passing through the Gulf, we're going to be crossing the Atlantic, we're going to be passing the south of Portugal. All of these nations have an interest in regulating the transaction. If something goes wrong, all of them can potentially assert jurisdiction. And so what the parties did is in their services contract, they stipulated that any disputes arising out of the transaction are going to be heard before the High Court of Justice in London. As it happens, there was a bad accident. The oil rig was basically destroyed. And the Supreme Court enforced that forum selection clause. It sent the parties to London to resolve claims arising out of this dispute. That had some effect on the parties' rights. At the time, English courts would enforce exculpatory clauses that U.S. courts sitting in admiralty wouldn't. But the effect on the overall regulatory environment, I think it's safe to say, is pretty minimal. By going to London, we're swapping out English tort law for American tort law as the rule of decision. You think about how that's going to affect regulated actors' primary decision making. It's difficult for me to see too much of an effect. All right, so now fast forward to 2012. The issuer of the Aspire Visa card attempted to do something very similar. I'm going to hazard a guess that no one in this room has ever considered applying for the Aspire Visa. It has a credit limit of $300. It is specifically designed for people who have terrible credit histories and are trying to rebuild their credit histories. And the marketing material that came with the card made the offer that if you use this card responsibly, it's going to help to rebuild your credit history, it's going to help to rebuild your credit score. So far, so good. The first snag is that buried in the terms and conditions are a bunch of back-end fees that impose cost of about $270 on consumers who sign up for this card. So the representation that this is a credit card and that the user will actually be extended credit starts to look kind of dubious. Now, I'm going to also go out on a limb. I'm going to say that people who are signing up for the Aspire Visa card probably aren't going to be the most effective pro se litigants. They're not going to be people who, when they realize what's in the terms and conditions, are able to assert their rights. And so if this fraud is going to be redressed, if this, you know, this seeming violation of regulatory law is going to be redressed, there has to be an agent that acts on behalf of the affected consumers. So one possibility is that we could have a public agency do it. We could have state AGs do it. But that seems unlikely. I did some research on the Credit Repair Organizations Act, which is the federal statute that governs these kinds of cards. When the act was passed, witnesses before Congress told Congress that there were about 500,000 of these companies operating in the United States. I was able to find a handful of settlements and I think 8 cases where a claim under the Credit Repair Organization Act had actually been litigated in court. So it seems like public enforcement isn't a viable option for this claim and for redressing this harm. And so that leaves the private sector. That leaves private sector attorneys who, through some formal or informal aggregation mechanism, are willing to undertake a representation of people who signed up for this card, who are out $270 with no possibility of relief. It's at this point that contract procedure enters the picture because the Aspire Visa card, in addition to the back-end terms and conditions, also has an arbitration provision that, through reference to the rules of the National Arbitration Forum, prohibits any form of aggregate claiming or class actions. And so really takes the possibility of private enforcement off the table. And makes it impossible for a private sector attorney who needs to be compensated through a contingency fee to redress this regulatory violation. So contrast that with what happened in the Bremen. In the Bremen, we're reducing transaction costs. We're not setting up a situation where there's a substantial effect on the regulatory power of U.S. law. Now we look at the situation in CompuCredit. All of a sudden, through the magic of contract procedure and weak public enforcement, we're in a situation where the governing statute, the Credit Repair Organization Act, really ceases to have any regulatory effect on parties who are operating in the real world. If you're one of the 440,000 credit repair organizations in the United States, you look at enforcement patterns, you look at the protection that you're going to get through the arbitration provision, and I think you can safely conclude that this law just doesn't apply to you. There's no reason to worry about what it says when you're advertising, when you're developing new financial products. So the question is, is that right? And do we want the law to reflect this state of affairs? The CompuCredit agreement worked the way it did because we have a body of arbitration law that gives a very, very strong presumption of validity to anything denominated in agreement to arbitrate. There's some subject-specific carve-outs in areas such as mortgages, in areas such as blowing the whistle on accounting fraud. But for the most part, following the last two decades of Supreme Court case law, agreements to arbitrate come into court with an extremely strong presumption of validity. If we're looking at contracts that modify the procedures public courts use, the law is a little bit more unclear. The law is pretty clear that forum selection clauses and choice of law clauses are going to be enforced in most cases. Academics have talked about the possibility of modifying things like the burden of proof or the pleading standard or the availability of class action procedure. We really haven't seen test cases that are dealing with the enforceability of those kinds of contractual provisions. The rulemaking committees have not taken it on so far, so there's some legal uncertainty there. But the question is, and I think this applies for policymakers at all levels of the government, whether we're talking about Congress, whether we're talking about administrative agencies like the CFPB that have delegated authority to regulate arbitration, whether we're talking about judges who I do think have some capacity to use intelligence and common sense.
He just meant as opposed to us former federal bureaucrats.
You know, the question is, how do we approach these things? How do you know, if you're a judge, what do you do when the defendant mm-hmm. says, yeah, sorry, judge, we've agreed to use a different dispute resolution system? Mm-hmm. What do you do if you're the CFPB and you're studying the enforceability of mandatory pre-dispute arbitration? The suggestion that I want to make is that for all of these policymakers, Congress, agencies engaged in rulemaking, agencies engaged in adjudication, judges, self-regulatory organizations, across the spectrum, the enforceability of contracts that define dispute resolution systems should be driven by regulatory compliance in the real world. Are people who are regulated by federal law generally complying with the norms that federal regulatory law sets up for their behavior? And the idea is that when regulated actors are generally complying with the law, when there's a general state of compliance, then we should be as welcoming as possible towards contract procedure because it provides a way of experimenting with different procedural forms, capturing some transaction costs that otherwise would be lost to public court litigation. On the other hand, when actors in the real world are in a state of non-compliance, that's when we should look at contract procedure with the most skepticism, and whether we're talking about Congress, whether we're talking about agencies, whether we're talking about courts, it should be tightly restricted or taken off the table altogether. So I have just a few minutes left. Let me just really quickly explain why I think compliance matters. Insofar as we're talking about Congress, it seems to me that the key point is that when we're looking at regulatory domains that are enforced primarily by private litigants, Congress is the institution of government that's playing a role similar to what we would normally see a public prosecutor playing, right? If you're looking at a regulatory domain where a prosecutor is picking and choosing cases to prosecute, the prosecutor in the exercise of prosecutorial discretion is in charge of keeping track of whether regulated actors are violating the law in the real world, directing enforcement actions to areas where the violations are most egregious, where litigation is going to have the most deterrent effect. And in areas where enforcement is primarily done by private individuals, we see Congress playing a very similar role insofar as it's driving enforcement patterns by setting up particular incentives to litigate it, by providing enhanced damages, by providing fee shifting, by making changes to the substantive law that affect the availability of aggregation under Rule 23. And so my claim is that Congress in these privately enforced domains is functionally acting like a prosecutor exercising prosecutorial discretion. And so just like a prosecutor should be concerned with whether people are violating the law a lot in the real world, so should Congress in enacting regulatory legislation. Insofar as we're talking about institutions that encounter contract procedure ex post, they don't have that same democratic mandate. They don't have a mandate to say, where should we direct enforcement? Where do we want to see enforcement actions? But they can at least check and see whether laws that were clearly designed to have a regulatory effect on people in the real world are having that effect, right? It's very difficult to say, given just a regulatory statute with some private enforcement apparatus, what Congress actually intended with respect to rates of litigation, with respect to the kinds of claims that should be prosecuted. But the suggestion is that when we look at a statute like that, we're sure, if nothing else, that Congress wanted regulated actors' primary decisions to be affected by the regulatory norm in the statute. And I'm happy to go into it more in the Q&A, but that seems to be something that courts can test for, that agencies in an adjudicatory posture can test for, and also something that has a pretty strong foundation in positive law.
Okay. Thank you very much. David, really a quite thought-provoking paper, and again, I think it, like Adams, helps us see connections that we might not otherwise see between judges' kinds of questions about how to think about arbitration clauses and those of Congress. I do think that maybe we'll talk about a little bit when we get to the moderated portion of the panel, the difficulty on an ex post basis of making those judgments is, I think, quite different from the ex ante judgment. In the case of Congress looked at the fee harvester case that you described, and essentially in the Card Act prohibited fee harvester cards now. And similarly, Congress looked and said, well, we give the CFPB the authority to make this kind of compliance judgment you're talking about for consumer products and the SEC for investor products. It's harder to see judges making that same type of trade-off between public and private enforcement, though, as I mentioned, the Austrian judicial system saw this huge void in public enforcement and stepped in with collective redress. So it's not impossible. I just think teasing out how that's going to be done is quite... And with what standard will be quite challenging. But Mark, I hope, is going to tell us that the whole exercise is a mistake, and then we can have a debate about it.
Well, I'm not going to. The first thing I'm going to do is find out how I get an Aspire Visa card for my kids.
You mean with one with no credit?
Well, the one with no credit and the $300 limit. that combination would be perfect.
But you missed the part about the $270 fee.
It's only $270.
I'll pay the fee in exchange for the protection. So, Troy,
we can do business.
I think the reason that I was asked to speak on this panel is really twofold. Firstly, I split my time pretty much evenly between commercial litigation, including class actions, and regulatory white collar. I spent a lot of time negotiating with regulators and DOJ in the space that we're talking about, and I frequently, as is true with Eric and a couple of other people, Sheila and others who I see here in the audience, I frequently am involved in cases where there is simultaneously a regulatory or criminal component and either a contemporaneous civil component or a follow-on civil component. And so I can give some sense of kind of where in private practice and in the corporate world people are viewing these things. And I found some of the comments really interesting, and I'll kind of respond to a few of them as I go through this. I mean, I come at this, I hate to use the word cynically, but what I would say is that I come at this from the perspective of somebody who was hired to give strategic advice and to be tactical about how you deal with all the things we're talking about. So is this a situation in which we should really focus aggressively on this class action because it's got it's got legs and we're going to have to deal with it? Is this a situation in which we can defeat certification and so at that point we don't have to worry about it? Are these plaintiffs lawyers who we can deal with and we can, you know, essentially pay off early on in this process? Are we better off dealing with our regulator first because they've already got their teeth in this thing? And so, it's a multidimensional process for the people I represent, and I don't think, by the way, all of this is nonsense. It won't surprise you to learn that I don't believe class actions are generally effective, either in affecting corporate conduct or in protecting members of the class. It's not to say that you can't identify some class actions that were successful and that performed all of the functions that Rule 23 had in mind, but I can tell you that a very high percentage of the class action cases that I'm involved in, and they span lots of different industries, are really not designed to benefit the members of the class, and frankly, rarely do benefit the members of the class. I think on this issue of enforcement, one of the things that's happened that everybody knows about, that these guys have talked about, is that cases that used to be kind of relatively plain vanilla regulatory, and I say regulatory as opposed to criminal investigations, or cases that were civil, commercial cases, class action or otherwise, or that were multi-district litigations. Many more of those cases, a much higher percentage, are now cases that we're dealing with as regulatory white-collar cases, mm-hmm. Particularly in the consumer space. It's just 10 years ago, if you were representing pharmaceutical companies or car companies or a manufacturer of some widget in the Midwest, 95% of your time you were focused on civil cases. Mm-hmm. It was really unusual and rare to be in a situation where a case had criminal and regulatory implications. And it's just the opposite now. Now it happens really routinely. And when a case is a relatively high profile civil case or class action, that will sometimes trigger the interest of the regulators or DOJ or the state attorneys general who act in a pack at this point and individually don't necessarily have that much juice, but collectively as a group, are a force to be reckoned with. So traditionally, cases moved slowly. There was time to investigate what had happened. There was time to develop defenses. We didn't need to deal with competing demands from regulators, from DOJ, from Congress. The amounts in controversy tended to be manageable. And class action litigation was really all about deciding pretty early on, could you defeat class certification or did you have to deal with class certification and then pivot and deal with the plaintiff's lawyers? I see Sheila shaking her head because she's done this many more times than I have, but pivot and deal with the plaintiff's lawyers. And, I have to say that the effect on corporate conduct, to the point that you guys were making earlier, in other words, at the end of the day, if your client settled a large class action case, how interstitial was that to the conduct of the company going forward? What kind of an impact did that have on senior management? Did the impact, flow through the organization in a way that really fundamentally changed corporate conduct? And I think, and I'm looking at Eric to see if he agrees or Sheila if she agrees, but my sense of it has been that when you settled a class action case, even a large class action case, it was kind of, that was a business decision and you did what you needed to do and you moved forward. The criminalization of these cases has fundamentally changed all of that. And if you're talking about what benefits society, not necessarily what benefits some of my clients, but if you're talking about what benefits society, in what circumstances do the plaintiffs or the putative class members do better? And more importantly, in what circumstance does the company, the entity that's involved, take to heart the message and fundamentally change its conduct? There is no comparison in my experience between the impact of a class action resolution on the one hand and the impact of a criminal resolution on the other, in which there's a large class of individuals who are who were affected and who are now being paid restitution. And it's certainly the case that in some of these resolutions that we do, you don't have a complete match between the group of people on the regulatory side on the one hand and the group on the class side on the other, and that's because the way you define the class and the way the government perceives the harm, you know, aren't always completely consistent. But in many cases, and actually as the government has become more sophisticated about this, and they have, they've actually gotten much smarter about it, and as class action lawyers have decided that one of the ways to do this is to ride the coattails of the government and actually do less early on and let the government develop the case, there's actually been some evolution to the point where I think the overlap has actually increased in the cases, again, at least in my experience. And so if you're in a situation where you have a class action mechanism on the one side or you have a criminal regulatory mechanism on the other, and your goal is to affect corporate conduct, I think you're better off as a society with the latter. And I say this because the amount of time and money and effort that companies are putting into compliance is at a completely different level than it's ever been before. So, you know, if you take a class action on the one hand and say, we've got a class action case and we've got to deal with that as kind of run-of-the-mill litigation, that's one piece. But if you've got a government regulation, you've got a public relations problem that is probably bigger than it is if it's just a class action. You have state attorneys general who are always going to get in the game. You obviously have Congress, which is going to get in the game when it's appropriate. You now have the CFPB, which, you know, it's too early to tell how it's going to play into all of this. They've only filed, I don't know, six or seven, some relatively small number of matters. But I'll tell you that from my client's point of view, the CFPB is something that people are learning about. They're you know, it has their attention. Mm-hmm. Obviously in the financial, you know, big bank world in particular, but also in other worlds. You know, in a government case, you're going to have securities litigation. And so what's happened is the process has become much more politicized. There's much more of a criminalization. At the end of the day, and you know, again, you know, talk to some of the practitioners here. If I'm negotiating against a group of plaintiffs' lawyers in one of these cases, I have, very simply, I have leverage. I have a lot of different levers that I can use in that negotiation, including I can delay. I can litigate. I can impose discovery. I can you know, argue on the merits and actually be right most of the time. Whereas when I'm dealing with the government, I have almost no leverage. And a lot of what I just described, frankly, including the merits, doesn't always make much difference. And so people say to me, you know, why do you do both white collar and civil? One of the reasons I do the civil piece is because I actually like to fight over these issues from time to time. And I'm not exaggerating when I say to you that when you're dealing with these issues, you know, these large cases that affect large numbers of people and that are high profile, the combination of impact on large populations and a lot of profile makes it very, very difficult to resolve the cases. But I think from a compliance point of view, the impact is that companies are, you know, much more compliant than they were, and they have systems and structures in place that are designed to inculcate compliance, to train, and to actually make companies function in a way that is more consistent with the rules than they might have otherwise. You know, on the issue of arbitration, you know, without naming any names, I do have clients who are looking, and not just in the credit card space, but in a lot of different areas, that are looking at the idea that it might be a benefit to be able to require arbitration and a waiver of the class action mechanism. But I think some of the assumptions about the way the arbitration will play out in that context probably aren't entirely accurate, even from the defense side. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is first of all, the notion that arbitration is going to be inexpensive in these situations, that, you know, you can do this on the cheap and some poor individual is going to come in pro se and you're going to spend 5 minutes resolving their case and then you're going to go to the next one, it just hasn't played out that way in many circumstances. And so it's, you know, while obviously defeating class action, a class action certification has a bunch of benefits and basically takes the leverage away from the plaintiff's lawyers, in a situation where you have hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of arbitrations, if you're really looking at arbitration as a real alternative to class resolution, where individuals are actually going to be part of a process, you know, that's going to be very expensive. And I've had some cases where we've tried to do sampling, you know, so we've tried to use a set of cases as a way of measuring damages and then, you know, allocating to the rest of the group. But it's much harder when you're doing individual arbitrations because, number one, the individuals don't have to agree to it. Number two, generally speaking, the courts won't require it. Mm-hmm. Number three, if you're in a situation like that, you know, in a class context, particularly where we're trying to settle, both sides are going to take the position that all of these issues are typical. Mm-hmm. As to, you know, all the members of the putative class. But once you're in an arbitration setting, the individuals who are arbitrating, generally speaking, are going to take the position that they're not like everybody else. And every one of them is going to try to make the case that they are, you know, kind of like Lake Wobegon. You know, right. Everybody's above average. And so as a result of that, in cases that I've been involved in where we thought, and none of them are, you know, tens of thousands, but they are hundreds or thousands of individuals where we thought arbitration would be easier. It hasn't necessarily been easier, and it's actually been quite effective for the individuals. And so I don't think the idea that, you know, you put one of these clauses into an agreement and suddenly you're home free, I just don't think that that's completely inconsistent with my personal experience in a handful of these cases. Just see what else I wanted to.
So you got 1 minute left, Mark.
Respond to.
if it's a response to these guys, I'm about to give you a chance to do.
Why don't I end with that, and then I'm happy to answer whatever questions you have.
Please join me in thanking Mark. And again, Mark's presentation, like Adam's and David's, shows the importance of this interplay between public and private. And I think that's just an incredibly fruitful way to think about the issues that we've been struggling with today. And let me just start by asking, maybe we'll go down the line and see whether David, Adam, and Mark want to respond to anything each of them in particular said. And please take 1 minute to do that each.
From my perspective of somebody who's arguing that we need to calibrate public and private enforcement and we should be focused on the bottom line of where compliance is at in the real world, I'd love to hear what you're saying, Mark, because it seems to me that if you're getting an effective driver of compliance from criminal actions, then it seems much less worrying to me to go along with what the Supreme Court has been doing in the arbitration area and sort of other innovations in procedural contracting. If you're in an area where you don't have the DOJ or the SEC or an agency driving compliance, you know, which is, you know, my selected Aspire Visa example, mm-hmm. Then, you know, then I start looking at private enforcement. I start looking at class actions. I start asking, what can we do to preserve those? I think, again, looking at this at the policy level, the question is, how do we manage that relationship? How does Congress manage that relationship? How do agencies do it? How do courts do it? And I think really we're in very uncharted terrain here because the Supreme Court has pushed us in an area where we all of a sudden have to look at this. But we don't have a good framework for thinking through these questions.
Well, I think one of the things that has changed pretty dramatically, and this may seem kind of like not a huge point, but it has a huge impact, is that boards of directors at companies have the definition of their fiduciary obligation as a result of the government's conduct has changed. And I spend, and I'm sure Eric spends, you know, a fair amount of time. In fact, three times this year I've been asked to meet with boards of directors to talk about what is the board's obligation mm-hmm. with respect to compliance in particular. Mm-hmm. And it's not just enough that you have an audit committee and, you know, your head of compliance reports once a year. That's gone. And in a derivative context where you have questions about what was senior management doing and what was the board doing, and in a mass tort context where increasingly what the board was doing, and certainly in a securities context, what the board was doing is, and in OIG in particular, in the pharmaceutical space, very focused on mm-hmm. board conduct. DOJ in the pharmaceutical settlements, in the CIAs that companies have entered into, mm-hmm. they have a specific requirement that boards, not just management, certify compliance. And if that is broadened beyond pharmaceuticals and beyond the
financial industry. It's true, as you know, in finance, in spades.
Right, in the financial industry, if you get beyond those two, I mean, it makes a big difference. So mm-hmm. The board piece is important.
Adam, did you want to add anything to the first round?
Let me think. So I think that one reaction I had to your talk, David, is the extent to which agencies already kind of regulate contract procedure and what you think about it. So, you know, CFPB is still studying arbitration. The SEC also, you know, has authority to regulate, but it's also made kind of informal moves to kind of regulate. I mean, it's essentially, it's threatened at least one company that it wouldn't allow them to go public if they included arbitration provision in their IPO. And it seems like there's other ways in which agencies regulate contract procedure too. So the Department of Labor has regulations for, you know, employment mediation, like kind of and arbitration that's kind of created ex ante and has suggestions and recommendations as to like how the company should organize those teams. So I guess I'd like to hear a little of your take about the extent to which agencies are already kind of actively, through informal mechanisms or maybe even more formal mechanisms, already trying to accomplish that goal. And why, if you feel at all that they're not doing that, if you feel that there's some reason why they're not, like I always think of the SEC's position with respect to why it's so far not been very happy about the idea that arbitration clauses be included in IPOs or other types of shareholders agreements is mainly because they like private enforcement. They think it's important supplement to their function. So do you think that agencies are not doing it enough already, or what's your take on the current scheme for regulating contract procedure?
So the SEC has held up one IPO.
But that sends a signal, too.
Sends a signal. Eventually, somebody's going to litigate that, and the SEC is going to get smashed in the D.C. Circuit because they're taking actions that are inconsistent with the Federal Arbitration Act without a statutory mandate to do so. One thing that I wonder about is the extent to which agencies monitor private enforcement. The SEC, you know, for decades has taken this position that private enforcement, the standard line is that it's a necessary supplement to the public enforcement activities of the commission. It seems to work because there's almost a division of labor between stock drop, class actions, and the other activities that the SEC does. From what I've looked at, I'm not convinced that agencies are monitoring private enforcement, that agencies are aware of what's happening in court, that agencies are even asking regulated companies what they think about private enforcement. Some of this has to do with the woeful lack of data about what happens in public court. It's hard for an agency which is going to have sort of a nationwide perspective to get a systemic view of what functions private enforcement is performing effectively and which functions it's not. In terms of sort of where I'd like to see us. I think what Michael did in Dodd-Frank is great. I love an explicit statutory direction to study this, where you're going to get funding for statisticians and economists and lawyers to do a systematic data collection. I have lots of thoughts about the kind of things they should be looking at. Mm-hmm. But I think if we're in a world where we're asking agencies to manage the relationship between public and private enforcement, in the long run, they're going to need statutory authorization to do that. They're going to need appropriations to do that. And there's going to have to be an understanding that this is something that's legitimately within the sphere of agency action.
So let me just make a brief comment on that comment, and then I'm going to open it up to the floor. So the SEC does have, and the CFPB does have already, explicit statutory authorization to address that question.
Okay.
So it's not just that they study it. In both instances, at the conclusion of the study, they have the authority to prohibit or condition, if it's appropriate, mandatory pre-dispute arbitration clauses. And both agencies, by virtue of their discretion in how they enforce the law, effectively make judgments about the level of public enforcement. And I think your point is, when they're doing that, they should have better data and keep in mind what the actual level of private enforcement is, and I totally agree with that. Let me look to all of you for questions.
Break the law school stuff. Is it on?
I can yell.
Okay.
I'm just sort of curious, your idea that we're going to have arbitration clauses in these contracts, which is already going to deter lots of great lawyers from getting involved in these cases. But then some lawyer's going to get involved anyway. And the lawyer's going to have to prove, on your view, the lawyer's going to have to prove that there is some regulatory gap, some vacuum. And this is why private
we're quaking in our boots.
And then the judge, right, Lee's going to have to sort of figure out what's the answer here, and what does she look at? Is there sort of a battle of the experts? Can we look at sort of the micro? Is an SDRA claim, is privacy being regulated sufficiently, or is it more about a sort of more at a higher level of generality? What is the framework? What does this matter? But mainly, I just feel like what the problem is with these class actions.
Can I ask Judge Rosenthal to add her thoughts on this too, and then maybe you can respond?
Sure.
David, do you want to answer all those questions?
Yeah, no problem. all right, so Miriam, as you know, there's been a multi-decade effort to come up with an as-applied test that tells us when an arbitration agreement has gone so far, gone too far. In Italian Colors, in Concepcion, you see Justice Scalia, who is perhaps not the most sensitive to detail person in the world, saying the whole effort is a waste of time. He's on record as liking rules, so I can I can say that. So I do think in terms of if we're in a world where we're within the framework of existing Supreme Court case law, we're not seeing statutory interventions, I do think that one way we can make the analysis a lot more tractable is by forgetting about plaintiff's lawyers. Almost every attempt at developing an as-applied test that we've seen in the doctrine has started in World One, where you can bring a class action in federal court, then go on to World Two, where you're subject to an arbitration agreement. And the question is, well, is the effect on litigation economics sufficiently serious that we want to bar our enforcement of the arbitration agreement? That's an impossible question to answer, because the things, the people who are in the plaintiff side here can speak to this better than I can. The things that motivate a law firm or an attorney to represent a particular client, to litigate a particular claim, I think are enormously complex. Some of that is going to involve the efficiencies of aggregation. Some of it's going to involve alternate uses of the attorney's time. And for a court to get a handle on that, for a court to say, are you changing the economics of litigation in a way that's impermissible, seems to me to require the court to answer an impossible question. And also sort of raise questions about, do we want judges who are supposed to be neutral as between the parties saying that, no, this harms the plaintiff's law firm too much. So it raises questions about the judicial role. What can judges do? Judges can look at the post-arbitration, post-procedural contracting world and say, if I'm the regulated actor, if I'm a firm that's subject to the Civil Rights Act, that's subject to Dodd-Frank, that's subject to Sarbanes-Oxley, are there material incentives for me to comply with the law? That's not always going to be easy, but that's the kind of question lawyers answer all the time. We just want to know what's the liability exposure, what's the worst thing that could go wrong. And it seems to me that at least where you can say there's no material incentives to comply with the law, then it seems to me that the way contract procedure is working is inconsistent with congressional intent.
So I think we have time for one more question. Maybe from someone who hasn't yet asked a question. So let me ask all of you to join me in thanking this terrific panel.